On December 16th, 2021, Cloudflare's frontline team was getting ready to deploy a new version of the frontline, which was their first line of defense against enemy attacks. The frontline primarily handles distributed denial of service or DDoS attacks, which is when enemy computers spam garbage requests at a particular network to try and overwhelm it. Many websites use Cloudflare's DDoS protection, which works by first directing web traffic to a Cloudflare server that verifies the query is legit before forwarding it to the real server or origin. The frontline will periodically send traffic samples to various helper services like the denial of service daemon or DOSD. Daemon here simply refers to a background process originating from the supernatural being famous for completing mundane tasks like automatically updating Windows when your laptop is closed so that it overheats and drains all your battery. Anyways, DOSD will analyze the traffic, and attack fingerprints such as IPs deemed malicious are given to the frontline, which blocks matching requests. So the frontline deployment was a bug fix for how Cloudflare servers handled requests which had a no transform header. According to the RFC, this header is supposed to prevent any intermediaries like Cloudflare from modifying the payload, which means no compressing or minifying content. However, Cloudflare had been incorrectly compressing content with this header for years, so the fix was simply to correct this behavior. Some of you may already see a problem with this. Indeed, some customers had become dependent on the buggy behavior. For example, a service with limited memory may have been sending requests with a no transform header, getting back to compressed content and functioning normally. Then, after the bug fix, it would correctly get uncompressed content, run out of memory, and crash. This wasn't actually that big of a deal, only a few people were impacted and the change could easily be rolled back. The engineers performed the rollback in two batches, the first to the smaller tier 2 and 3 data centers, and the second to the larger tier 1 data centers. They started the first batch at 1925 UTC, and it completed in about 30 minutes. After verifying there were no issues, they started the second batch at 2110. Within minutes of starting the second batch of rollbacks, alerts started firing.
Traffic levels are dropping. CPU utilization is dropping. AP0 incident has been automatically declared.
Somehow, a rollback deployment to known good code, successfully performed just 40 minutes earlier and limited to a subset of the network, was causing a global problem. Customer queries around the world were experiencing extremely high latencies of up to 5 seconds. Like every other Cloudflare incident we've covered thus far, this was a priority zero, all hands on deck emergency, so dozens of engineers immediately hopped on the call to determine the root cause. They paused the rollback, but that did not fix the problem. Then they began looking to see if it was due to an external attack, but they found nothing. Then the DOS team, which manages DOSD, the helper service which analyzes sampled packets, received a concerning alert. DOSD is not running on numerous servers. Looking at the logs, they saw that DOSD was panicking, which in Rust means the program encountered an unrecoverable error. It would then automatically start back up and get stuck in a crash loop. This was because DOSD was failing to read customer addressing data from Quicksilver, Cloudflare's superfast key value store. DOSD uses this addressing data to understand what kind of traffic is expected on particular IPs. The data changes infrequently, so it is updated 10 after every hour by a simple Kubernetes cron job, which runs a bash script on this set schedule. This script would simply query the addressing API, which was a Cloudflare service that provided the addressing data, and write the data to its designated Quicksilver key. But for some reason, the key that was supposed to have addressing data instead had an empty value. And DOSD was not programmed to handle this edge case. The engineer's gut instinct was to manually re-trigger the cron job and see what happens. So they did just that at 2140, and seconds later, everything returned to normal and the empty key was restored. Despite fixing the issue though, they had no idea what just happened. There was always a risk of reoccurrence, so the engineers wanted to get to the bottom of this ASAP. The DOS team looked into why DOSD not running was blowing up the company, and others looked into why the key was empty. They inspected the Kubernetes cron job, which was something that looked like this. Breaking it down, the left commands in the parentheses are part of a pipeline, indicated by this vertical pipe symbol. This makes the output of the first command the standard input for the next command. DOS make adder conf queries the addressing API and outputs formatted data, and T reads from standard input and outputs it to a file. So evidently, we were trying to output addressing API data to a config file of the TOM's obvious minimal language format. Lastly, .ctlset will set the quicksilver key template vars to the value of this config file. Can you spot the issue here? If DOS make add your conf fails, it will have an incomplete output, in this case nothing at all, which is teed to a TOML file that will be blank. Then this blank file is passed to .ctl, which ends up writing a blank value to quicksilver. Okay, so why does this first command fail? The engineers dug into the logs and saw that the request to the addressing API was timing out. Checking the addressing API metrics at the time, it was clear that the API was severely overloaded. But upon closer inspection, they saw an interesting correlation. The traffic spikes for the API lined up exactly with the rollback progression. It didn't take long for them to put two and two together. The rollback process for frontline not only replaces and restarts the application itself, but also reruns various configuration scripts, one of which calls the addressing API. The rollback of thousands of servers would overload the addressing API and cause requests to be queued. This didn't affect the rollback, as the request would eventually be served as long as the client didn't time out, so the first rollback was fine. The second rollback, however, was coincidentally triggered at the exact same time as the cron job. Unfortunately, the cron job had much less patience and gave up on talking to the addressing API, which led to the blank quicksilver key, which caused DOSD to fail to start up. So the last piece of the puzzle is why DOSD failing to start breaks the front line. The front line consists of the request handler and a caching layer. DOSD itself doesn't serve requests, and the front line will asynchronously query it every few seconds for new attack fingerprints and store them in the cache. When requests come, the request handler checks the cache for attack fingerprints, and if they aren't there, that is, in a cache miss, the caching layer will attempt to reach out to DOSD for the data. Since the rollback restarted the front line and wiped the cache, this is exactly what would happen. The problem is that while the caching layer waits for DOSD to reply, and it never will, it will block all incoming requests until the call times out, which takes 5 seconds, after which the requests are allowed to progress. Then the cycle repeats and new requests start queuing again for 5 seconds. So the end result is Cloudflare delaying requests for up to 5 seconds during the impact time, which lasted about 30 minutes. There are 4 clear fixes that can be made to address this incident. Pause the video and ponder for a bit what you would do to improve the system. Firstly, there was the cron job, which ran a broken bash script. Like steam.sh, it did not use bash strict mode, so random unintended buggy behavior was executed despite commands failing. Pipelines by default exit with the code of the last command, so as long as the last command succeeds, bash thinks everything is good. Pipe fail makes it such that the first non-zero exit code will always be returned instead. Then the -e error exit option makes the script exit after the pipeline fails, preventing the key replacement from being called. Secondly, DOSD did not gracefully fail when loading configuration data from Quicksilver. The error which occurred was not properly handled, which ended with a crash loop. Cloudflare has since added in the logic to allow DOSD to gracefully degrade when given bad Quicksilver data. Thirdly, the front line had an unexpected dependency on DOSD. In these types of failures, you either fail open or fail close. For example, if the authentication layer for the nuclear launch code API goes down, you probably want to fail close and prevent the request from continuing. On the other hand, if a service that simply inspects requests for data analysis purposes goes down, you would want to fail open and allow the request to continue. There are gray areas though. For example, Cloudflare will allow users to choose what happens when they reach certain limits. Here, the intention was clearly to fail open, as after the 5-second timeout, the requests would be allowed to continue. This makes sense, as the front line is, as the name suggests, the front line, and there are more layers of defense behind it. However, the whole point of failing open is to prioritize availability over security, and there was neither availability nor security here. Lastly, the addressing API cannot handle all the servers querying it on rollback. This just meant it was underscaled, so they scaled it out. How many of these 4 lessons learned did you get? If you got all 4, then I would like to proudly present you with an opportunity to smash that like button.